Welcome, ma'am. Welcome, everyone. I think we'll start today's lecture. Today is the last of the series of lectures from the Department of Infectious Diseases for PG students specifically. Today, the lecture will be conducted by Dr. Priscilla Rupali. She has done a medical education in Christian Medical College, Vellore. She has done a diploma in tropical medicine and hygiene from the University of Alabama, Birmingham, and fellowship in transplant and infectious disease from the Henry Ford Health System. She is currently holding a designation as a professor in the Department of Infectious Disease and also being the deputy chair of HICC CMC Vellore. She is also the course director for the short course in clinical tropical medicine, fellowship in general ID, and fellowship in AMSP for clinical pharmacist, and also acts as a convener for global health and humanitarian medicine. Her research interests and field of work is mostly focused in internal medicine, infectious diseases, transplant ID, tropical diseases, and antimicrobial stewardship. So today we have our lecture based on for antimicrobial stewardship. The lecture will be for 3 to 4 p.m. Following the lecture, if any doubts, please drop the doubts into the chat box or you can ask directly. This lecture will be soon uploaded in the YouTube website of medicine. See you soon after this lecture. Thank you. Now over to ma'am.
Okay, thank you, Anju, for the introduction. I'm just going to try and share my screen and just let me know whether you're able to see it. Okay, are you able to see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. All right, so as you know that we've been working with an antimicrobial stewardship for quite a big period of time. And so I'm hoping to actually be able to kind of bring across to you what we do as part of HICC and as part of infectious diseases with regard to various stewardship activities. Okay, so all right, so let me just start right away. So for those of you who are interested in stewardship and would like to know more about it, the various free sources that are available online, and one very easy to read and colorful book is actually this Practical Guide to Antimicrobial Stewardship in Hospitals. The other one that is important is this is a guidelines published by the Infectious Disease Society of America about implementing an antibiotic stewardship program. This is both by the Society of Healthcare Epidemiology of America and the Infectious Disease Society of America. Okay, so I divided my lecture into two parts. One is basically telling you about the various strategies and the principles of antimicrobial stewardship. And the second part of it is actually a case-based practical approach to stewardship, which is something that you probably don't often do on a day-to-day basis. But this is just to bring home to you how our pharmacists actually do it when they actually see our patients in the wards. So what is antimicrobial stewardship? It's a coordinated set of interventions which are designed to improve and measure the appropriate use of antibiotics. How do they do this? They do this by promoting the selection of the optimal antibiotic, the correct dose, the duration, and the route of administration. This goes on to improve patient outcomes and leads to decreased adverse events. And among them, the predominant ones that we are looking for is actually the C. difficile infections and the antimicrobial resistance rates. So why do we need AMSP, as we call it? And this is a no-brainer. Obviously, every day in clinical practice, we're coming across increasing rates of AMR. And of course, the antibiotic pipeline has dried up quite a bit. Now, this is a set of maps, which is published by the CDEP, which is actually a Center for Disease Dynamics and something economics and prevention, which actually carefully monitors the various incidents and the prevalence of various drug-resistant organisms and actually do a global mapping all around the world. So as you can see here, whether it is MRSA or KPCs or NDM or ESBL, now, NDM and KPC, as you know, code for carbapenem resistance. You can see that India is colored dark here. Same thing with ESBL, India is colored dark. MRSA, we are not the darkest, but we are dark. And we have a similar incidence and prevalence as compared to the United States and some parts of Europe. So these are the various causes. We prescribe antibiotics quite a bit. Patients don't finish their courses of treatment. We use antibiotics quite a bit in livestock and fish farming. There is poor infection control in hospitals and clinics, which helps to propagate drug-resistant organisms. There's a lack of hygiene and poor sanitation again, which leads to spread of drug-resistant organisms. And unfortunately, there is a lack of new antibiotics being developed. And this is basically because there is very little money in treatment of infections. So the drug companies do not really want to invest money into developing a new molecule. As you can see, one molecule which comes into the market requires a lot of trials, and usually they end up spending almost $1 billion to get one molecule into the market. So the drug companies have been very hesitant to actually bring out a molecule which will be used for a finite period of time, unlike cancers, unlike, you know, antiretroviral therapy or diabetes or hypertension, which the patient actually uses for their lifetime. So that is a problem with developing new antibiotics. So as you can see, from 2010 onwards, there's actually hardly been any new drugs which have been developed. And it's been a source of great worry for all of us who have been dealing with infections on a day-to-day basis. So when we're saying we're combating antimicrobial resistance, there are three pillars that we need to talk about. The most important thing is optimizing the use of existing antimicrobial agents. Second is infection control related, which is prevention of transmission of drug-resistant organisms through infection control. Third, you improve environmental hygiene in general, or improve environmental decontamination. So what are the various drivers of AMR? Okay? And the various drivers are: one is human antimicrobial misuse or overuse. Second one is animal antimicrobial misuse or overuse. So both of them are factors which contribute to a high degree to antimicrobial resistance. Then to a moderate degree is healthcare transmission. And slightly lower than that is suboptimal vaccination for those diseases which can be controlled by vaccination. Environmental contamination, suboptimal dosing, that we don't use a drug that it's meant to be in the right way. Travel, we are traveling from one place to the other, constantly taking our microbiome, which may or may not contain drug-resistant organisms. And of course, there are other things like mass drug administration or suboptimal rapid diagnostics, which may contribute to antimicrobial resistance in a small way. So all of these are factors which can actually contribute to antimicrobial resistance. So when we're looking at trends in antibiotic consumption in India, as you can see, though this data is about 10 years old, really it's not changed very much. And India is one of the largest consumers of antibiotics. In 2010, it was the largest consumer, and you can imagine what it is today. So these are the usual fallacies in antibiotic therapy. We think broader is better. We think that anybody who's sick requires immediate treatment. If they don't respond quickly, we say that, okay, maybe there is failure to cover. We think that response implies diagnosis. When in doubt, change drugs, more diseases, more drugs, bigger diseases, bigger drugs, bigger diseases, newer drugs, and antibiotics are actually harmless. So these are all the fallacies. Antibiotics are by no means harmless. So this was a seminal article which was brought about by Kim Dayet in as early as 1989, so many years ago. And this article was titled Spiraling Empiricism. And it's an excellent article. And what was true more than 20 years ago is true even today. So how are we abusing antibiotics in our day-to-day clinical practice? So unnecessary antibiotic therapy is when we give for a duration that is longer than needed, when we have a non-infectious or a non-bacterial syndrome, when we're treating colonizers or contaminants instead of true pathogens, and when we're giving extra coverage or so-called redundant coverage, there is a problem. So for the goals for any antimicrobial stewardship program is you want to improve patient outcomes, you want to improve patient safety, you want to reduce resistance, and you want to reduce healthcare costs. Now, is there any evidence that it does any of the above? So we know that appropriate antibiotic use can improve patient outcomes. So this is one of these studies which was done in Public Health England. As you know, Public Health England closely monitors the antibiotic use in their setting. They actually have the BSAC, as you know, is one of the seminal bodies that actually writes guidelines and tracks the antibiotic usage in the whole country. So in this, you can see that when antibiotics were used appropriately, there was decreased need for mechanical ventilation. The length of stay before infection was also reduced as a result of appropriate antibiotic use. The mortality also was significantly lowered when antibiotics were used appropriately. So is there a mortality benefit? Now we're always like looking for a hard outcome. Is there a hard outcome here? Yes, mortality is definitely reduced. Economy and as well as appropriate bed usage, length of stay is reduced, and you're also improving patient outcomes in other ways. Now what happens when you actually implement a strict antibiotic stewardship program along with the stewardship program? Now in usual antibiotic stewardship metrics that we measure, one of the ways that it can be measured is the number of C. difficile infections that you have in the hospital. So that's like a surrogate marker of whether or not there is appropriate antibiotic use in the hospital. Now in India, we don't see too much C. diff, probably because we are overrun with other pathogens which we have, which are much hardier. C. diff is kind of a wimpy bug as compared to the others. But just to bring home to you, so this is basically a 4-week period where what they did was they measured the C. difficile associated diarrheas and they implemented various interventions. So when they started implementing infection control measures, which is in 2003 in this particular hospital, you can see that the incidence of C. diff infections did not really come down. But the moment they put in a stewardship intervention 1 year later, there was actually a marked reduction in the C. diff infections. So targeted antibiotics as well as the C. diff infections came down together when antibiotics were used appropriately. Okay, so this improved patient safety as well because it decreased the antibiotic use, it decreased C. diff colonization and infection, and there was no increased mortality or readmission that was noted during this time. So what do you notice in a given hospital the moment you start decreasing the use of a particular antibiotic? And this is beautifully illustrated by this particular graph. So in this graph, so the top panel is actually telling you about reduction in fluoroquinolone use. So what they did was they restricted fluoroquinolone use in this particular hospital. So as you can see from 2006 onwards, it was they restricted the usage. And as they restricted the usage, you can see that the fluoroquinolone resistant Pseudomonas aeruginosa rates dropped. And then the same way, the MRSA rates also dropped when they restricted fluoroquinolone use. So definitely restriction reduces colonization or infection with either resistant gram-positive or gram-negative bacteria. So it can definitely bring about a change. So what are the principles? Now I'll teach you the principles and these slides are often quoted by Dr. Osi. These are Dr. Osi slides. I will then take you through a bedside approach, what we do in ID as we see a particular patient. So these are the broad principles. They remain the same with anybody, whoever teaches you and in whichever part of the world you're in. So making a diagnosis, so trusting your clinical judgment and obtaining appropriate cultures, very, very important. So you can trust your clinical judgment to make a clinical diagnosis, but make sure that you're sending appropriate cultures to confirm your diagnosis. Whenever you're making a diagnosis, consider multiple things together, not just one value or one symptom or one sign, etc. whenever you're giving antibiotics, it's important to limit your empiric therapy. So there are very few indications where you definitely have to give broad spectrum antibiotics, and we'll come to that in a minute. Always re-evaluate empiric therapy. So start smart and then focus. And this particular phrase is taken from Dr. Dilip Nathwani's book, which I just shown you in the beginning. So this is what he practices. This is actually a phrase that he has used in public health. Very important to know our bug. So the hospital antibiogram, as you know, that we do submit every year. This year we have not done it because of COVID, but every year we bring out antibiotic guidelines, and those are based on the hospital antibiograms. How do we make it? We basically take frequently encountered bacterial pathogens in a particular clinical setting. We check their antibiotic sensitivity profile. Then we fit them into what we find as clinical syndromes that are commonly encountered in clinical practice. And we make our antibiotic guidelines based on that. Whenever you're using antibiotics, make sure you use them correctly. So correct dose, correct duration, correct dilution, optimizing the PK/PD parameters of every antibiotic that is actually used. So whether you're using a loading dose for colistin with extended intervals, or whether you're using a continuous infusion of beta-lactams, all of those have to be used correctly in clinical practice. So what about the next thing, de-escalation or modifying or discontinuing? So it's not just about de-escalation, it's also about discontinuing and modifying as well. So whenever you get an antibiotic report, very often the thing that is quoted to us is, okay, the patient is doing very well. He did well because we gave him that. But then you actually have an antibiotic susceptibility test, where it tells you very clearly that you can de-escalate because there is narrow spectrum antibiotics that are available. So it's very important to de-escalate, discontinue, or modify. So modify empiric cross-spectrum antibiotic based on ASD report, antibiotic susceptibility test reports, and the patient's status. So re-evaluate whether the patient needs polymyxins, whether the patient needs glycopeptide. Can you bring down a combination to a single agent? Can you broad from narrow from the broad-spectrum antibiotic? Can you narrow the spectrum? Can you change from IV to oral? And definitely this is feasible in febrile neutropenic patients and even in sepsis. So what does an AMSP team have? So generally it needs a physician leader with some amount of IV training. It's co-led usually by a pharmacist. And unfortunately, this is a model that is followed in the rest of the world. In our country, we do not have trained pharmacists who can actually lead a program. So in the rest of the world, the stewardship is actually led by pharmacists. Only in our country, we actually need a doctor to lead this program. It has to be a prescriber-led program. So somebody who's prescribing the drugs needs to lead it, and it cannot be led by a non-clinician. Because the more it is led by a non-clinician, the less likely they are to actually understand the clinical scenarios. We need hospital epidemiologists and infection preventionists to monitor, to audit, to analyze, and to report facility-wide data. You need quality management staff to be on board so that they can actually check the quality of the various orders that we are doing, and it becomes a patient safety issue as well. Luckily now, this is not such a problem because we have a set number of things that we need to do as a result of the NABH. The micro lab needs to be on board. They need to develop antibiograms to guide an empiric antibiotic therapy. You need various IT staff who can integrate stewardship into the existing workflow that is seen in the wards. Nurses who can ensure that the cultures are actually taken before starting the antibiotics. So these are the keys to the success of our AMSP program. The clear aim or vision that stewardship is a patient safety priority. We need management support and accountability. We need a strong and influential clinical leader who can lead the team. There have to be effective communication structures built into the program so that various departments can communicate with the AMS team. All stewardship interventions should be evidence-based, and we should be able to measure the effectiveness of any intervention that we have taken. we have to educate and we have to innovate as we go along. So what works in one hospital may not work in another hospital. Always have short-term goals and then actually consolidate the short-term goals with something that works out to be a long-term success or gain in the long term. Okay, so now I'm actually going to take you through a bedside approach. Those are the broad principles and strategies. I'm not going through the various stewardship strategies. I'm going through various stewardship principles and how we can do it at the bedside. Those of you who are interested further in stewardship, can drop in anytime. We actually run a fellowship in antimicrobial stewardship for pharmacists. And we actually have Jisha who's enrolled as part of that. So anybody who's interested can easily come and learn from Jisha or Hannah or Pavitra, our pharmacists. So this is what we do when we see a patient. So first step, remember we talked about making a diagnosis. So I think when you see a patient, I think the most important thing is it an infection? And when you say it's an infection, part of that also includes a risk assessment. How likely is this patient to have this infection? Is there a non-infectious mimic that can mimic an infection? And maybe it is that and not really an infection. When we're thinking about an infection, I think it's very important to take appropriate specimen cultures to be able to come to an eventual diagnosis, which will help you to take your cultures or stop your antibiotics. Then we need to ensure that if you start an antibiotic, what are we starting it for? Is it a life-threatening condition that needs immediate introduction of an antibiotic? Or is it possible for us to actually wait and make a diagnosis and then give targeted therapy? Ruling out colonizers or contaminants, very, very important after you take appropriate specimen culture. So once you get a specimen culture back, you will know whether or not the organism that you're seeing in the blood culture, in the urine culture, is actually a true pathogen or whether it is likely to be a colonizer or contaminant. That will not be possible unless you take the patient's clinical status into consideration and also whether or not you think it is a true infection. Now, what is a step two? Step two is empiric antibiotic therapy, which is can we reasonably predict the infection given the risk factors of the clinical condition of the patient. Now, let's say you make a diagnosis of, say, a urinary tract infection. Now, when you're making a diagnosis of a urinary tract infection, you also take the clinical conditions and the risk factors of the patient into consideration. Is it a catheter-associated UTI? Is it a patient who is a diabetic? What is the likelihood of the source of this particular infection? And what are the likely pathogens which are likely to be present? And most importantly, do I really need to give an immediate antibiotic, or can I wait, make a diagnosis, and then give appropriate therapy? So there are very few situations where you need to give antibiotics urgently. And these are the three conditions where you want to give antibiotics urgently. So febrile neutropenia, severe sepsis and septic shock, acute bacterial meningitis, community acquired pneumonia, ventilator associated pneumonia, and necrotizing fasciitis. These six conditions, we don't wait because it can actually impact life or death. So these six conditions, we don't wait, we go ahead and institute empiric antibiotic therapy. But generally, all others can wait and it will not really harm a particular patient, or at least wait till we can take appropriate cultures. Then how do you choose an antibiotic? So when we choose an antibiotic, you want to make sure the spectrum of the chosen antibiotic is appropriate. So let's say you have a UTI, you've thought of all the organisms that are causing UTI. Make sure that the antibiotic you choose covers the entire spectrum of organisms which can cause that particular infection. Is this antibiotic in keeping with local resistance patterns? And is the antibiotic going to penetrate the tissue that you're targeting? So let's say you're targeting the urinary tract. Are we targeting the bladder, are we targeting the kidney, are we targeting blood, are we targeting lung? So the tissue penetration should be appropriate. So there are a variety of antibiotics which will not penetrate the tissue that you're attempting to cover. You want to give them the correct dose, the correct route, and the correct duration. and you want to make sure that after microbiological confirmation is obtained, you're able to ensure clinical efficacy. Adjust to various host comorbidities like liver or kidney failure. Now the don'ts. So we've done the do's. What are the don'ts? Don't give antibiotics if there is no clear-cut evidence of infection. Don't give it longer than necessary. Don't give double coverage or redundant coverage. If you have an alternate viral or fungal pathogen diagnosed, which can suitably explain the clinical condition, be bold enough to stop the antibiotics. If there is a failure to respond, always think. It is not always failure to cover, and you do not actually have to upscale the antibiotics or escalate the antibiotic choice. Don't change drugs or add other drugs without a clear-cut reason as to why you think there is a failure to respond. Okay, now let's go on to the case scenarios. And I'm hoping to get some answers from people here. I know with Zoom, it's very difficult. It's often difficult to, you know, get answers. But I'm hoping you'll be able to do it. So let's quickly do these. And I hope to get one or two. Anju, you can actually point out or tell one of the PGs to answer this as I go along. So this is a 75-year-old male, a diabetic, who presents with a 7-day history of swelling of the left lower limb with pain, bullae, and pus discharge. Patient also has an NSTEMI, which is diagnosed during admission, and he has a mild respiratory distress. He shifted to the ICU. He requires intubation, and he undergoes a debridement and a plantar fasciotomy on the day of admission. So these are his vitals. His heart rate is 89, respiratory rate is 18, saturation is 95%, these are his other labs, relatively okay. The NSTEMI is the reason why he has a trophy that is 131, and he has some perihilar opacities that we can see. So he was actually, many cultures were sent for this patient. Patient was admitted actually in the surgical ICU. So urine culture done, no growth, blood culture done, no growth. He has a culture sputum, no growth. He also has an influenza PCR for whatever reason, and he is negative for influenza A and B. Then he has a superficial pus swab, which is polymicrobial, which shows MRSA, Pseudomonas, and Streptococcus. Okay, so question number one. Who wants to answer as to what the diagnosis is?
PGs, any of you can answer if you don't want to be picked up on.
So the diagnosis here is? They can't someone speak, is it, Anju? Okay.
Someone has replied saying necrotizing soft tissue infection.
Okay, I'll check the chat. Sorry, I didn't know we could check the chat. Okay, good. So he has a necrotizing skin and soft tissue infection, and he also has an NSTEMI. Excellent. So what are the likely organisms? And is this among the, this is a polymicrobial swab. Is this likely to be correct? Andrew, they can't speak, right? They can only chat, is it?
No, ma'am, they can speak.
Okay,
they can speak.
They don't want to speak, I suppose.
Mercy, you want to answer that? Or Ruth, since they've given the diagnosis.
Okay, so, sorry, what is... So Streptococcus is a possible organ, probable organism. Excellent. So this is a patient who has Streptococcus. Which group Streptococcus?
Raghul Sen.
Streptococcus pyogenes, ma'am.
Yeah, absolutely. Okay, good. So what would you like to give as the empiric choice of antibiotic?
Aminopenicillin with beta-lactamase inhibitor.
Aminopenicillin. Okay, so or beta-lactamase inhibitor. What did you say? Both are two different things. You want a beta-lactam?
Combination of amoxicillin and clavulanic acid.
Oh, amoxicillin and clavulanic acid. So you want to give something like Augmentin to this patient?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay, all right. Sure. Anybody else? Okay, let me show you what the patient actually went on to get. Okay, so yes, so he was actually in SICU, and he was initially put on piperacillin tazobactam because he was presumed to be sick, and he was also given clindamycin. Is everybody agreeable with that? Rahul, what do you think? You think it is okay?
This beta-lactamase could be a little narrow covered. It's quite a broad coverage.
So tell me what all is wrong with what you've seen here. So he was initially on piperacillin tazobactam and he was on clindamycin. Then he dramatically improves by third day, becomes afebrile. CRP and procalcitonin have come down remarkably. And subsequently, the patient is changed to linezolid and azithromycin, which he is given for 14 days. So tell me all the things that could possibly be wrong here. You said you wanted Augmentin. Okay, just chose Piptaz. Well, Augmentin and Piptaz, there's not too much difference really, except for pseudomonal cover that is additional. So let's say Piptaz, are you okay with Piptaz as the initial drug of choice?
Yes, ma'am, okay.
You're thinking it's okay, all right. What about clindamycin?
Clindamycin is not routinely needed.
Okay, what is the diagnosis here? Necrotizing skin and soft tissue infection, isn't it? So probably what he had is a neck thrush. So clindamycin here is actually given for toxin pop-up. Okay. How long do we give the clindamycin usually in those days, in those situations?
For 5 to 7 days.
Okay, no. So usually we give it for 2 to 3 days. We don't need it beyond 3 days. No. So Piptaz was given for 6 days here, but he is dramatically improved by third day. So what do you learn from this? Did he really need Piptaz for 6 days?
No.
What do you think? So generally, you find that clinical improvement. So we all have these magic numbers of 7 days and 14 days in our heads, right? Anybody knows if there's any evidence for that? There is no evidence for that. So in fact, in the infection control and stewardship world, this is a bit of a kind of a joke. They say that this was 7 days was designed by Emperor Constantine. So these are like Constantine days. We only go by 7, 14, 21, etc. But really, we should go by the clinical condition of the patient. So there is no magic number of 6, 7 days or 14 days. So generally, if you find that a patient has improved dramatically by the third day, by the fourth day or so, you should be confident enough into stepping down into an oral therapy from an intravenous therapy. Procal also has come down. So Procal coming down is actually a good measure of stewardship and can help you to de-escalate, discontinue, or modify. Now let's say it's necrotizing soft tissue infection, patient was severely ill, a patient was hypoxic, hypotensive. You don't want to really reduce it dramatically. Say you want to give 7 to 10 days of antibiotics totally, maybe give a few days of IV and then change to oral. What oral drug would you like to change to? Mercy, do you want to answer that question? So do you approve of what this patient was given?
There is no reason why he should get azithromycin, ma'am.
Excellent. Okay. What about linezolid?
Maybe he can go for 3 more days of total duration of 7 days with Augmentin alone would have sufficed. Excellent. Because we've achieved source control.
Correct. Excellent. So once we've achieved source control, you go clinically according to what the patient seems. So you whatever the beta-lactam or beta-lactam inhibitor you want to choose initially, that's fine. Piperacillin tazobactam or whatever it is that you use, give it for the requisite intravenous duration is basically based on the clinical response. And then step it down to oral therapy after that for a total duration of 7 days. So excellent. So we know that there is always this doubt, are we really reducing the duration and will it impact the mortality of the patient? There are numerous RCTs which have demonstrated that shorter regimens are clinically efficacious in cellulitis, bacterial sinusitis, community-acquired pneumonia, ventilator-associated pneumonia, complicated UTIs, and intra-abdominal infections, etc. So if you look at this, I don't know how many of you are aware of this study. It's called the STOP-IT study. What they did was they just did aggressive, this was intra-abdominal infections. Patients came in, they were operated, and 4 days later, antibiotics were stopped. And they compared it to a group which actually got the 10 days or 14 days therapy. And they really found no particular difference between the two. So now in most countries over the world, based on this particular trial, nobody really goes beyond 5 days of antibiotics for a particular patient. Okay, so this is an important take-home message that it really doesn't impact your mortality or morbidity if you're reducing the duration of antibiotics. All of you are aware of this study done in ventilator-associated pneumonia. It's a very old study where they compared 15 days versus 8 days of therapy, mortality, recurrence of infections, MDR pathogens, antibiotic-free days, and even other clinical endpoints which are important to the intensivist, ventilatory-free days, number of organ-free days. All of those did not actually differ. Recurrences also did not occur with NFGNBs, provided you gave 8 days of therapy. So definitely there is enough and more evidence to say there is a Cochrane meta-analysis with this regard as well, with regard to hospital-acquired pneumonia, and whether it is pyelonephritis, UTI, anywhere you look in any source of infection, we know that shorten the duration of antibiotic therapy than possible. So I think this is only possible when you make a firm diagnosis, when you send appropriate cultures, you're confident that this is the organism, so you're able to step down therapy based on your clinical judgment. So shorten the duration of antibiotic therapy whenever possible. Okay, let's go on to the second one. This is a 45-year-old with a history of analgesic abuse, presented with a sudden onset abdominal pain, septic shock with ARDS. Diagnosed with urinary ulcer perf, undergoes emergency laparotomy, has a patch repair. She started on injection meropenem and gentamicin and flagyl. So what do you think about that? Anybody wants to comment on the antibiotics that were chosen?
When meropenem is started, we need not add this gentamicin and flagyl. Meropenem itself will cover most of the pathogens that are added towards by gentamicin and flagyl.
Excellent, excellent. So what is that called? That's called giving redundant cover. And so wherever you go, if you find that flagyl is started along with meropenem, you don't actually need the flagyl at all, nor do you need gentamicin, because meropenem technically covers everything that gentamicin covers, except probably enterococcus. Enterococcus is probably the only organism where there is slightly better cover with gentamicin. Of course, you could even have high-level gentamicin for enterococcus, but that is something to take into consideration. So very, very good. So this patient actually goes on to SICU on ventilator, not an inotropes. He has a chest x-ray, which is showing an opacity. Pus culture has shown ESBL E. coli, which is sensitive to piperacillin tazobactam. So what do you want to do at this point in time? Anybody? Nobody?
Sanu, do you want to answer that?
Okay, so we were talking about de-escalation and modification. I'm just looking at the time, so I'll just answer that myself. Now, meropenem is a necessarily broad spectrum, isn't it? So when you're looking at the urinary ulcer perf, you know there are a certain number of organisms that they can possibly have. And if a person has never been exposed to a hospital, if the person has never been on antibiotics in the last 1 year or so, then it's unlikely that the person will have any drug-resistant organisms on board. But anyway, whatever you start with, when the patient is sick, you don't argue. You just go ahead, let the patient start whatever the physician start whatever they want. But once you find the culture reports, you can always step down therapy. Now, here you find the ESBL E. coli is sensitive to piperacillin tazobactam. Do we want to step down to tazo? What does everybody think?
Yes, no, we can step down to piperacillin.
Okay. So, okay, great. So it's okay to step down to piperacillin here. But what about the Merino trial? Has anybody heard the Merino trial? Okay, so Merino trial was basically designed to answer a question whether in bacteremias where you have ESBL E. coli, could you actually substitute to piperacillin tazobactam when it was susceptible rather than continue on with meropenem? Okay, so now very often this Merino trial will be quoted at you by the intensivist, but remember the Merino trial was done in the setting of a bacteremia, but not where the blood cultures are negative, source control has been achieved, and the pus is actually showing you a clear-cut sensitivity to piperacillin. So Merino trial did show there was some mortality benefit with continuing meropenem as comparing to piperacillin tazobactam. But here there is no bacteremia, source control has been achieved, really doesn't make sense for us to continue with meropenem. Okay? So like I said, meropenem covers most gram-positives, most gram-negatives and anaerobes. And these are all the antimicrobials that are effective against anaerobes. Okay, so this is the avoid redundant or double coverage or gram-negative and anaerobic cover when you're actually giving meropenem. Okay, somebody raise their hand. Yes, Vineet, you want to share what you want to say? Vineet, do you want to say something? Okay. All right, I'll go on. So this is the third case. This is a 21-year-old male. He is a student from Bangalore. He had a primary HLH diagnosed in Manipal and was given a variety of treatments with regard to that. And after two doses of etoposide, he has hypotension, leukopenia, hypoxia requiring ICU care. He was stabilized and subsequently he was actually referred to CMC Velo for consideration for a bone marrow transplant. So he's pale, he's febrile, his blood pressure is low, and he has crepitations, he requires intermittent NIV. He has a hepatosplenomegaly, and perianal exam was normal, but otherwise he has no other signs and symptoms. So this is his hemoglobin, this is his WBC count, and his platelets are slightly low. And as you can see here, he has a slight Deibel elevation. But procal is 2.9, he has a blood culture which is negative, urine has shown some candida glabrata. So, while in the ward he develops hypotension and shortness of breath, he's shifted to ICU. He requires inotropic and ventilatory support and bone marrow cultures are done, bone marrow is done and then cultures also are done and then he gets started on meropenem and colistin. Okay. So this is his blood culture report. So what do you want to do after this report has been obtained? What do you think? Do you agree with this? Okay, let's go on to this question as such. So what do you de-escalate? Yes, no, maybe. I'll have a quick look at this. What all does it show? He's on meropenem and he's on colistin. This is an ESBL E. coli. He's on two drugs. And this is his blood culture susceptibility. Can I ask somebody to answer as to what would you like to do at this point in time? Would you de-escalate? And what would you de-escalate to?
Do someone want to answer the question? CCS to stop colistin.
Okay, great. So I think it's very important. And this is a situation you will face in the medical ICU, AICU at any given time. Patient has improved because he's on meropenem and colistin and I want to continue. But I think it's a very important thing to remember. despite the fact that he's febrile neutropenia, he's had severe sepsis, you would go ahead and actually de-escalate. So I wanted to show you this particular study because this is something that you will come across in clinical practice, whether it's hematologists or intensivists who will refuse to de-escalate. So this is a de-escalation of empirical therapy in the sickest of sick patients, okay, with severe sepsis and septic shock. Here, this is a PCOS. Intervention was discontinuation or change of antibiotic to a narrow spectrum, and the control was no de-escalation, and they looked at in-hospital mortality and morbidity. And here, de-escalation was actually protective, and that's the reason why we believe that even in the sickest of sick patients, even if you started out with two antibiotics, it's appropriate to go ahead and reduce to nirubenafide. So de-escalating to a narrow spectrum as soon as possible, very, very important. But let's say this is a 44-year-old banker. She was operated on for umbilical hernia last week. She did short-term Foley's catheterization, and this was remote post-surgery. She has no comorbidities, no history of fever and urinary complaints. And exam-wise, everything really is normal. Surgical scar also is looking good. This is her urine routine, and this is her urine culture. What do you think about this? So this is something that actually happened, I'm sorry to say. So what do you think, guys? Asymptomatic bacteruria, excellent, okay. Need not treat, okay. Unfortunately, this patient went on to receiving nirofenem for 10 days. So I wish it was everybody knew this. So did she need this antibiotics and what adverse effects do you see? Now I'm going to ask you guys a question. Let's say you took antibiotics for a week. And what happens after you give antibiotics for a week? Does it alter your gut flora and for how long? So Sakshi, can I ask you to answer that? So how long does it take for the gut flora to return to the wild type that you had before the initiation of the antibiotic? How long does it take?
Not too sure, ma'am. I know it alters the gut flora and is like makes the patient susceptible to other infections, but I don't know what how long it takes.
Take a guess.
Maybe around 1 week, ma'am.
Anybody else? 6 to 9 months. So Nivin, you're right. Actually, sometimes it takes anywhere from 6 months to a year. So you're absolutely right. So remember that if you by any chance have, if you take an antibiotic, it's altered your gut flora and God forbid you develop another infection. Remember the gut flora does not come back to normal. So the chances are that when you do get an infection at that point in time, you will get a drug resistant infection. Okay, so this is what you see all the time in hematology patients, isn't it? So you give a course of antibiotics, the gut flora is altered, next time they come, they will be resistant to that particular antibiotics because the gut flora has been wiped out. So it does take ages for the gut flora to return back. And this is most elegantly demonstrated by a group of travelers from Finland who actually came to India, believe it or not. So what they did was they did a rectal swab showing nice, beautiful, pan-sensitive E. coli. They come to India and then they go back. Some of them actually even had diarrhea, traveler's diarrhea. Some of them had taken antibiotics for the traveler's diarrhea. And when they went back, it took almost a year for the people who were treated with antibiotics for the traveler's diarrhea to recover their original wild-type flora. The ones who were not given antibiotics took a little less, but definitely it was more than 6 months. So it's very, very important to remember that whatever decision you're making with regard to antibiotics is based on sound science. So yes, it can not only predispose to C. diff, colitis, and candidemia, it leaves you, it wipes out the wild gut flora, leaving multi-resistant bacteria to proliferate. It leaves the individual prone to multi-resistant infection later on. Remember that this person will transmit his genes to anybody else, so other bacteria, and of course, if he gets an infection, it leads to increased hospital and drug costs. So definitely do not treat colonizers or contaminants. Not sure why this patient was even, urine culture was even sent, for this patient, but it was an intern who just ticked it off and sent it mechanically as part of a protocol, and then ended up getting unnecessary neuropen. Okay, Shreya, you have raised your hand. Do you want to ask a question or something? So ma'am, even if we see ESP in asymptomatic patients, should we not give an antibiotic? So Santosh, I'm going to throw the question back at you. Which is a patient that you would treat?
Post renal transplant and during pregnancy.
Okay, post renal transplant, when would you treat? So remember, a post renal transplant, you actually get antibiotic prophylaxis for a bit of time, isn't it? Now, yes. Different hospitals, hospital settings do it differently. In our hospital, we do tend to give it in the perioperative period and up to a month. In some hospitals, they actually give it up to 3 months, but we don't follow that. Most people, there is increasing data emerging that you don't really need to give it for a long period of time. So the earlier guidelines would have said you need to give 3 months of antibiotics post transplant, but we no longer believe that's true. We think that that should be considered in people who have an altered anatomy. Now, whenever people are, you know, embedding the ureter into the kidney, into the bladder, there may be some kinking, etc. Those may be the patients you may consider, but most often or not, we don't actually continue to give antibiotics in those. One thing that you forgot, sorry, one second. More important answer that I was looking for instead of pregnancy was actually a person undergoing a urological procedure. So if you're going through the urinary tract, then you may actually not have to treat, you prophylax. So you will actually give them prophylaxis during the procedure, preceding the procedure, maybe peri-procedural. Okay, but you do not really have to give it for a prolonged period of time. So most people who have, multi-drug, you know, CRO, CLEMBO, something in their urine, and they have some complex urinary procedure that they're doing, what we do is we admit them one day early, we will give them some, IV antibiotics while just before the procedure, and maybe one dose peri-procedural, and that's it. And then you wait and see whether they have any other symptomatology. This is the high-risk patients. Pregnancy, yes, you're absolutely right. Now, pregnancy, it again depends. Generally, we don't do a urine culture up front. You would actually do a urine dipstick, or you would do a urine analysis. And if you find that eventually there is asymptomatic bacteriuria and you have to find that there is ESBL E. coli, what would you give? Who asked the question? What would you give, Santosh? What would you give as a particular choice for a pregnant woman? What would be safe? You need to treat them, or what would you do?
Ma'am, in general, we will give nitrofurantoin.
Okay.
But in ESBL, I don't know.
So ESBL, nitrofurantoin actually works. And if you give nitrofurantoin, you give it as 100 mg TID for 3 to 5 days for a pregnant woman. What is the other drug that you can do? You can give fosfomycin, just one stat dose of fosfomycin, 3 grams stat for a pregnant woman. Believe me, I've seen patients where a pregnant woman was given ertapenem for 1 week just because they isolated ESBL. So all these are unnecessary things. We have good oral drugs available for pregnant women, which will be safe. Nitrofurantoin is not particularly safe. Fosfomycin is actually category B, so it's safe in pregnancy and can be given as a single dose. So it's the best drug to be actually given to a pregnant woman.
Okay.
What is the role of fecal transplant in antibiotic stewardship? Can we come back to that in a little bit? Let's finish off the various cases. Anju, please tell me when to stop. I don't even have my phone with me, so I don't know the time. So please tell me to stop whenever you think is required, because I have plenty of cases. Okay, so let's do this case. There's a 66-year-old male, a fever and cough, pleuritic chest pain, smoker. He is febrile, he's tachycardic, he's tachypneic, his saturation is slightly low, he has bronchial breathing. Other system exam is remarkable. So your diagnosis is? Come on, people. What's the diagnosis here? Yeah, good. So he undergoes various tests, and here this is his total counts: 18,000 neutrophilic leukocytosis. This is his chest X-ray, and what do you find there on the chest X-ray? Okay, somebody quickly, necrotizing pneumonia. What is the likely organism? It's likely to be Staph aureus. So the moment you find that there is necrosis on the chest X-ray, it's not a lobar consolidation, it's unlikely to be strep pneumo, it's likely to be Staph aureus or Klebsiella or one of those things. Klebsiella again is usually the upper lobe. If it's middle lobe, usually it is likely to be Staph aureus. So unfortunately for this gentleman, he has MRSA. His bank MIC is intermediate. He has daptomycin, which is susceptible. He has linezolid, cotrimoxazole, and doxy, which are all resistant. What would you like to give this patient as treatment? Quick answers, guys. Anybody? Vancomycin? Okay, but vancomycin is intermediate, and mind you, the MIC is 4. Generally, anything above 1, we are hesitant to give vanc because they will not respond like you want them to respond. So this is a trick question, that's why I put it up. Anything else? Okay, so ideally you would have said, okay, it's linezolid, but this unfortunate guy is resistant to linezolid as well. So what else would you like to do? Would you like to give Dapto? Dapto doesn't penetrate lung, absolutely. So what would you like to give? Teicoplanin? Well, teicoplanin, when your vanco is resistant or intermediate, teicoplanin will not work. It's a glycopeptide, same as vancomycin, remember that? Okay, the correct answer here is clindamycin, okay? So you would actually ask for clinda susceptibility, and the trick to recognizing clinda susceptibility is looking at the erythromycin susceptibility. If it's susceptible to erythromycin, it's likely to be susceptible to clindamycin. If erythromycin is resistant, then you ask specifically for clinda susceptibility. They will do what is called as a D-test, and they will tell you whether it's clindamycin susceptible or not, okay? So you're quite right. I'm so glad, Sanuj, you didn't fall into the trap, top trap of giving, or Rahul, is it, giving daptomycin. So very, very important. And this is a mistake often that is made. There are situations where you will come across this, and it's important to think broadly as to what you can do for a particular patient. You never match a test tube or petri dish to the bedside. You always, matching the drug to the bug. Basically, one size does not fit all when it comes to dosing or duration of therapy. So antibody PK/PD definitely needs to be taken into consideration. Okay, so you're quite right, daptomycin gets inactivated and bifunctional surfactant when it's actually used. So for a pneumonia, daptomycin is a big name. Okay, so do not use antibiotics which are not efficacious at the site of infection. There are a variety of these drugs, for example, tigecycline and a urinary tract infection, echinocandins and urinary tract infections. All of these do not work in that particular site, and it's important to actually remember that. Okay, 57-year-old man, fever, dry cough, diabetic, hypertensive, hypothyroid, CKD, maintenance hemodialysis, creatinine 6 and hemoglobin is low, and he has microbiology lab tests, so blood cultures, no growth, and he has a dengue serology, all those kind of things are negative. And he has an influenza that is positive. This is his chest X-ray. What do you do? Patient is on a mechanical ventilator. He's on inotropic support, alternate day maintenance hemodialysis. He's on meropenem. So he's CKD stage 5, volume overload, and he's also got H1N1. What is the next thing that you do? So Rahul, are you saying no antibiotic? What would you do? Stop it?
Yes, ma'am. Probably the X-ray and picture all consistent with the bacterial, isolated bacterial pneumonia.
Sorry, say that again. It's all consistent with the bacterial pneumonia.
I mean, so sorry, flu, influenza.
Okay, so the X-ray picture is consistent with a viral pneumonia rather than really a bacterial infection. So what would you do with the meropenem? Stop it.
We'll wait for a culture. If negative, we'll stop.
Yeah, blood cultures are negative.
Then we can stop.
Okay. Yeah, so I think it's important to consider that. Is there any tool that you can use to be confident here? So Sanuj wants to stop if cultures are negative. So Sanuj, you're always worried, right? Am I dealing with bacterial infection? Is there anything that can help you? You have an influenza PCR that's positive. That's the biggest help. You already have a diagnosis. Apart from that?
Procal, ma'am.
Procal, excellent. So if you have this fabulous PCR, which will tell you what virus it is, you're safe. And antibiotic prescriptions are definitely reduced when you do a PCR upfront for respiratory viruses. So lots of studies have demonstrated that, and it's important for us to do that. So Procal. So Procal is a very important stewardship tool. So whenever you're in doubt, you're worried, or even the team, the intensivists are worried, Procal definitely can help you discontinue all antibiotics in acute respiratory tract infections. They can help you de-escalate, they can help you modify, they can help you to discontinue. So Procal is a very important tool which can actually help you do that, okay? So they help as ASP tools in case of doubts. Okay, I hope this is the last one. This is a 17-year-old male. He has a fever, left lower limb swelling, fall in the well, no comorbid illnesses. He's come to us, he's in septic shock, and he has a left swollen tender knee, a left knee debridement. Blood culture shows Staphylococcus aureus, and lo and behold, is an RSA. And he started on antibiotics. All right, so he has multiple blood cultures his pus from the knee also shows Staphylococcus aureus, okay? What do you want to, so he goes ahead and he gets started on vancomycin. But he continues to have high spikes of fever with leukocytosis despite appropriate antibiotics, okay? So then they think in terms of source control, he undergoes even a left knee arthroscopy despite the first drainage, and they find there's nothing much else happening. So I want to just, I want you to notice the dates here. So this is 25th of August. That he had this line showing Staphylococcus aureus. Okay, then 1-9, so that means 6 days later, he still actually has knee aspirate showing Staphylococcus aureus. In fact, even his pus and eventually his sputum also showed Staphylococcus aureus. So what do you think is going on? He started to have this, but something is happening here. What do you think is going on? Anybody? Is he responding, not responding? Do we need to change antibiotics here? What do we need to do? So 6 days later, he still has MRSA growing from everywhere. What do you guys want to do? Low bank chalk levels, we need to increase the dose. Okay. Why do you think, Shreya, the bank chalk levels are low?
Ma'am, the renal, there's already a renal disease that's there. There's an underlying CKD, so we would have given a reduced dosage, and in the presence of a CKD, no, it's a very...
This guy doesn't have, he's a 17-year-old child. There is no CKD. So I want you to look at why, the reason I put up the EGFR calculator over there. Can you see that? So Shreya, can you see his creatinine was 0.22? What
yes,
is his
ma'am.
GFR?
601 ml per minute per 1.73 meter square. It's normal.
Yeah, it's normal. What is a normal GFR?
I'm about 16.
Hey, come on, guys. Okay, 150. I cannot believe I'm telling you guys this. Okay, so can you see that his GFR is much above what is required? Okay. So if you say your GFR is anywhere between 125 to 150 is acceptable. Can you see this young guy's GFR? It's 600. It is actually really, really high. Okay. So that is the reason why he was actually probably not achieving the appropriate WANC trough level. Okay. So whenever you're dealing with a young patient and you find that they continue to have fevers and they're isolating organisms continuously, for God's sake, don't add on drugs or change the drugs. First, sit and calculate the GFR and make sure that you're giving the correct dose of antibiotics. So this is what we did in this patient. We were called and consult for this patient. I remember that this was a community acquired MRSA, which tends to be extremely virulent. And what we did was, all we did was ask for a WANC trough level. And we calculated the eGFR for this guy and we found it was 600. Then we actually went ahead and increased his dose to 2 grams IVBD. So immediately his fevers, everything actually subsided. So it's very, very important that anything that we consider, you have to take the host also into consideration. This guy doesn't have any CKD. This 17-year-old guy who's basically has an extremely high GFR and he was washing out the vancomycin. Okay. So it's very, very important to remember, in a critical care setting, you almost always have subtherapeutic drug levels in critically ill patients. So whether it is beta-lactam, whether it is your low molecular weight heparin, whatever it is. So you have to ensure that you're checking, especially with drugs like vancomycin, a trough level, to ensure that you're optimizing the trough dosage here. Okay. So if you have a creatinine clearance, which is more than 130, we're so used to concentrating on the lower GFRs, we forget there is an entity of high GFRs as well. So when you have a high GFR, you're likely to be associated with a low trough concentration. So that is something that you keep in mind. So this patient, I remember it was an interesting consult for us. So if you have a failure to respond or failure to cover, please don't add or change another. Make sure that whatever you're doing it the correct way and finding a scientific explanation, especially when you have a culture which shows you otherwise. Okay. So I'm just going to quickly end now. Generally, antibiotics are given empirically in high mortality infections. We dealt with this. And this is the mortality associated with these particular infections, which is the reason why we go ahead and give empiric antibiotic therapy after taking appropriate cultures. So as you can see, neck fash has mortality up to 35%, back meningitis 15%, community-acquired pneumonia 12%, ventilator-associated pneumonia 50%, febrile neutropenia 10%, but in the given situation, if they're in septic shock, it can go up to 50%. So that's why we want to jump and give antibiotics in these patients, but always ensure that you've sent cultures so you have something to come back to de-escalate or and focus as to what we want to do. So this by no means do we ever say that we want to delay giving antibiotics. No, because we know that the chances of dying with early delay in antibiotics is actually quite high. So it should be given early in such a situation. Okay, so I think that's my that was my last slide. Happy to take any questions. I think there was one question which I did not answer, which was the fecal microbiota transplantation in antibiotic stewardship. Okay, so that's an excellent question. Now, right now, even in FDA, the fecal microbiota transplant is only licensed for severe Clostridium difficile infections. So infections where you do not want to go ahead and do a surgery. So remember, severe C. diff, which we don't see that often, by the way, ends up with basically a severe debilitating surgeries. You can also have a toxic shock. You can actually have a variety of problems as a result of C. diff. So in that case, in severe C. diff, you can actually consider doing a fecal microbiota transplant. It's a simple procedure to do, actually. And we haven't done it in CMC yet. We haven't needed to do it. But I do know that elsewhere in the country, people are doing it. In the US, it's commonly practiced because they see a lot of C. diff. And so for them, it's actually now pretty commonplace to actually go ahead and do a fecal microbiota transplant. Just to change the microbiome, FMT is not advised, not at this point in time. There are studies underway which show that if you do an FMT, it can even bring back a dysregulated immune response to normal. So there are studies in bone marrow transplant where it's they feel that FMT will impact even your incidence of GVHD or other rheumatic conditions. But so far it's hypothetical and it's not really used in normal clinical practice. I hope that answers your question.
With respect to the trough levels, what you said, if the patient is developing side effects with respect to antibiotic, so do we reduce the dose based just on the antibiotic? I mean, if to save related renal toxicity, do we need to do trough levels to see whether we are optimized again when we come down on the dose?
So I think one important thing I haven't put up here is actually the pharmacodynamic parameters for each antibiotic. So for vancomycin, when you're checking a trough level, you're going, basically it correlates more with toxicity than with adequate levels. So for vanc, it's actually AUC by MIC. So if you ask your clinical pharmacology, they will actually give you a nice AUC by MIC graph. And based on that, it will tell you whether or not you're achieving appropriate antibiotic levels. We often use it, I totally agree, as a therapeutic measure, but if you want to be absolutely appropriate and correct, even for vanc, trough mostly correlates with toxicity rather than actual therapeutic efficacy levels.
Any
vanc
further questions?
Poor bone penetration. Well, vanc has pretty okay bone penetration. I agree that tetracyclines like doxy, clindamycin, all of them have better bone penetration. But one quick note that vanc has better bone penetration than penicillins. So that's an important thing to remember. Penicillins have pretty low bone penetration, but we assume that when there is a bone infection, they will be able to absorb it.
Sure, ma'am. Any further questions? I think ma'am will be available even after the lecture. I think you can either mail it to ma'am or maybe message or maybe meet her in person if any further questions. We'll wind up for today. This lecture will be soon uploaded in our CMC Medicine website and YouTube. We are done with our infectious disease series of lectures. From next month, we'll be having geriatric and endocrine doing the lectures on their subjects. Thanks to all, and a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. It was very informative.
Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.